Thanks very, very much. Hey, good morning. It's great to be with you. Turn to your neighbor. Tell him it's all going to be okay in the end. Go ahead. Now turn to the neighbor on the other side and tell him it's all going to be okay in the end. And if it's not okay, it's not the end, right? It's wonderful to be here with all of you. And I want to thank you so very much for your kind invitation to be with you today. I also want to thank Sarah Gutterman for her generous introduction and also for her passion and her vision. Look, let me begin here. The Irish poet John O'Donohue once wrote, "The hearth, the fireplace, is the one area where nature in its elemental wildness is allowed to be present in the home. The hearth was the place where the civilization, sensibility, and intuition of a people was handed down. Never in an analytic or discursive way, it was always in the form of story." In 2011, students at the University of Maryland competed and took first place in the Department of Energy's solar decathlon. And blending affordability and consumer appeal, design excellence, and optimal clean energy production, not to mention better stormwater management, they built Watershed, a new kind of home, a home that produces and gives to the grid more renewable energy than it consumes. These young Americans, in other words, imagined a new reality. And more important, they brought it into being. The difference between a dream and a goal is a deadline. We are living in a time of profound transition. Climate change is no more an ideological issue than is gravity. Our earth is hotter, our oceans more acidic, our lands and waters buckling, right? Under centuries of stress, the carbon dioxide content of our atmosphere is now higher than it has been at any time in 3 million years. This, ladies and gentlemen, is an example of one of the greatest tools in all of modern municipal management. It's a graph. And this one is moving in the wrong direction. More than 3,500 national weather records were broken for heat, rain, and snow last year. And fortunately, we're beginning to understand. And let me show you something now with a graph that's moving in the right direction. This is the most beautiful sight in all of municipal government. It is a graph moving in the right direction. And the question here that was asked in this poll, this is from YouGov.com, is whether you believe that climate change is actually caused by human activity. Now, only 35% of Americans over 65 believe that's true. But look at where it's going. 72% of young Americans believe that climate change is actually caused by human activity. They believe the science. And if you want to know where a nation's headed, listen to the attitudes of her young people. Understanding precedes action. Climate change is the transformation that transforms everything. Our relationship to the world around us, our relationship to the other living systems of this earth, the way we live and work with each other, a transformation of imagination, a letting go, new solutions, new designs, new thinking, a new story for humanity. And you understand better than most the colossal nature of this challenge, the enormity of this opportunity. Greenhouse gas emissions must not only be capped, not only slowed, they actually have to be reversed. We must get to a point quickly where we start drawing down more carbon from the atmosphere than we are pumping into it. And that will require advances in how we generate and use energy. It will require new imagination to redesign our built environment. Yes, our homes and our buildings. This challenge, by the way, will also require a new way of governing, a way that people like Chris and this new generation of city leaders and managers are taken to like ducks to water. It's entrepreneurial, it's collaborative, it's performance measured, radically open and transparent. And we'll come back to that. More on that later. But as with all great movements of human development, we need artists. Artists will lead the way. So I want to talk with you about the opportunity of climate change. I want to talk with you about fire, imagination, the power of story, and the importance of place. Place matters, and we are surface dwellers. This is our place. This is where we have adapted and learned to thrive. And unlike any other animal species on the planet, we have progressed generationally by cooperating with each other. In fact, some might say cooperation is the new competition. And we've also learned to make progress by manipulating our environment, by extracting resources from the surface, the soil, the waters, the ground, and by learning to turn matter to energy. In fact, the story of Genesis is a story, among other things, of the conversion of matter to energy. Or was it energy to matter? The divine spark by which Earth achieved cognition in humanity. Over the last millennia or so, we human beings have learned to change matter to energy primarily by means of fire, the great discovery. Fire, the burning of wood in caves, fire, the burning of wood in stoves, and more recent time, fire, the burning of fossil fuels for heat, for electricity, for mobility. And in earlier generations, we thought that the land, the air, the waters were limitless, boundless. And only recently have we come to think about the finite limits of our planet, the natural capacity of Earth for meeting human needs, food, water, air, mobility, shelter. Today, from the perspective of space, we can see that the air we need is actually held in that very, very thin membrane. In fact, not only does that membrane hold the oxygen we breathe, but it also holds the carbon and the methane that we emit. For most of recorded human history, our stories of heroic people or individuals revolved around our capacity to conquer, our capacity to love, our ability to overcome great suffering, sacrifice, and loss. The Earth itself was usually merely a backdrop, or perhaps a wild or sometimes sinister thing to be conquered or consumed or controlled. But now we find ourselves on the threshold of a new era, don't we? The emergence of what American conservationist Aldo Leopold called the third ethic, after the Decalogue and the Golden Rule, the ethic of the land, the earth, the dawn of a new consciousness, greatly accelerated, I believe, by three important firsts. Number one, for the first time in human history, we have seen ourselves from outer space as we truly are, a tiny blue capsule of life hurtling through a vast universe. Number two, for the first time, a majority of us now live in cities. That's never happened before. And third, for the first time, our fires, the exponential growth of our traditional ways of converting matter to energy, have now superheated the planet. We are now pumping so much carbon and methane into the atmosphere that we are literally melting the ice caps, and we're threatening the very ability of the Earth to support human life in generations to come. So these are the threads. These are the threads from which we must weave a new story. A new story for the sake of our children and grandchildren. And it's not a story of scarcity and planetary disaster, not a story of ruinous growth and consumption run amok, but rather, I would submit to you, the most compelling of stories, a story of greater health and well-being, greater security, greater opportunity. Do you remember Apollo 13? Yeah? Apollo 13, another tiny capsule of life hurtling through space. In this case, the lives within the capsule were three American astronauts. After a near catastrophic malfunction, the capsule was crippled between the moon and Earth. Unable to maintain a proper balance of oxygen inside the ship, levels of carbon dioxide started to climb to life-threatening levels. The astronauts were literally poisoning the air they were breathing with each breath that they exhaled. Now, the young engineers and scientists and mathematicians on the ground at Mission Control had to figure it out. They had to find a way to draw down the CO2 levels in the air of the capsule. They created a duplicate pile of the very few materials that were in the spacecraft, all right, the duct tape, the containers, some tools, and they got to work. Their leader at Mission Control, Gene Kranz, kept urging the imagination and smarts of this young team of Americans forward. And when the NASA director muttered that this might be the worst disaster NASA had ever experienced, Kranz replied, "With all due respect, sir, I believe this is going to be our finest hour." Many of you have seen the movie, right? Work the problem, people. And they did. They fashioned a way to scrub the carbon dioxide from the air of the capsule. They saved the lives that only they had the power to save. And so too must we. Any appeal that begins from the standpoint of despair is bound to fail. Our story must be a story of greater health and well-being, greater security and balance, life lived more abundantly. We've become good, haven't we, at imagining the end of the world, but not so very good yet at imagining a new beginning. Consider these facts. There are now twice as many people employed in wind and solar jobs in the U.S. than there are in coal. In fact, solar alone now employs more people than are employed in oil and gas. The cost of rooftop solar has fallen 64% in 8 years. The price of land-based wind, 50% in just 4 years. According to the Bureau of Labor Statistics, average wages for a wind technician is $24 an hour. Solar, $20 an hour. Coal, $22, with more and more of those coal jobs going the way of automation. The U.S. advanced energy market is now valued at $200 billion. There are currently, get this, 2.7 million advanced energy jobs in the U.S., and many of those are hands-on, blue-collar jobs, employing more people than all of those employed in agriculture and mining combined. And when it comes to your own industry, the growth of green construction jobs has quadrupled by many estimates over the last 10 years. The truth is, there's a lot more jobs to be created by addressing climate change than there are to be created in ignoring or denying it, right? And there is one yearning the world over, and that is the yearning for a decent job. Now, let me talk to you about the here and now, and what we're experiencing together as a country. It is the law of all progress that it must pass through some periods of great instability. Let's repeat that lesson, shall we? It is the law of all progress that it must pass through some periods of great instability. The White House can be a powerful tool for human progress, but it is not the only tool. In fact, history teaches us that very oftentimes democratic republics make the greatest progress only after they have self-corrected from electing a tool. All progress is born of adversity. Just a few days ago, I hope you saw it, there was a great article in the New York Times. It was by Justin Gillis, in fact, on January 2nd. Now, warning, this article contains more than 140 characters. But it's really good. In fact, it's worth reading. And so, in an act of American resistance, I'm going to read it to you. Quote, with Donald J. Trump about to take control of the White House, it would seem a dark time for the renewable energy industry. After all, Mr. Trump has mocked the science of global warming as a Chinese hoax, threatened to kill a global deal on climate change, and promised to restore the coal industry to its former glory. The article continues. So consider what happened in the middle of December after investors had had a month to absorb the implications of Mr. Trump's victory. The federal government opened bidding on a tract of ocean floor off New York State as a potential site for a huge wind farm. Up, up, and away soared the offers. Interest from the bidders was so fevered that the auction went through 33 rounds and spilled over to a second day. In the end, the winning bidder offered the federal treasury $42 million, and that is more than twice what the government got in August for all oil leases in the Gulf of Mexico. Who won the bid? None other than Statoil, the Norwegian oil company, which is in the midst of a major campaign to turn itself into a big player in renewable energy. The article continues. We do not know for sure that the New York wind farm will get built, but we do know this. The energy transition is real, and Mr. Trump is not going to stop it. You can applaud for that if you like. I shall pass your applause on to Justin Gillis. On a global scale, more than half of the investment in new electricity generation is going into renewable energy. That's more than $300 billion a year, a sign of how powerful the momentum has become. Wind power is booming in the United States, with the industry adding manufacturing jobs in the reddest of states. When Mr. Trump's appointees examine the facts, they will learn that wind farm technician is projected to be the fastest growing occupation in America over the next decade. If Mr. Trump pushes for an early end to subsidies, he'll find renewable energy has friends in the Republican Party. Topping that list is Charles E. Grassley, the senior senator from Iowa. That state, all important in presidential politics, let us remember. Oh, will we ever forget? Will soon be getting 40% of its electricity from wind power. Now, I can tell you, having spent a little time recently in Iowa, that the people of Iowa are very, very proud of their wind industry, and they should be. It employs almost 5,000 people. So let me talk about these United States for a second. To look at a geographic map of the election returns, of the counties and the states, you would think that the continent is awash in a sea of red climate denial. But when the map is adjusted in this cartogram to reflect where the population of the United States resides, you see how and where Mr. Trump lost the popular vote. That map that looks, well, use your imagination. We'll have a contest afterwards and see what you saw on the map below. It was in all of those metropolitan bubbles of blue. You see down here at the end, it's Miami. You see Seattle at the up to the west, Boston in that area. And in between, deep red spaces. Deep red spaces where so many of our neighbors feel they're slipping through the cracks, that they're not recognized, that they're not seen, that they're not part of the emerging story. Urbanization and the drive for a more sustainable future have now been joined in one urgent movement of human development. And this is true not only here in the United States. This is a world phenomenon. As the prophet says, whatever is the more true comes out into the open, and whatever is better is ultimately realized. True story. When I was elected mayor, once a mayor, always a mayor, when I was elected governor of the state of Maryland, our state had no sustainable energy policy. In fact, our state had no energy policy. In an ill-advised utility hustle, our state had just moved from a regulated to a deregulated framework. And get this, residential rates, once a kind of temporary cap came off, residential rates in the Baltimore metro area went up 70% from one bill to the next. So it was against that backdrop of price sensitivity, to put it mildly, outrage and anger from the voters, to put it more directly, that we got to work. And we put together the consensus, the policies, and most important, the actions necessary to address climate change. With our miles of coastland and our natural subsidence, Maryland is one of the most vulnerable states in the nation to the impacts of climate change, namely sea level rise. Sea levels along our 3,200 miles of coastlines are rising 3 to 4 times faster than the global average. 13 islands in the Chesapeake Bay have now been swallowed up entirely, are no more. When I was a boy mucking around in the rivers and the marshlands of the eastern shore, the sea level was lower. Of course, when I was a boy camping in Glacier Park, Montana, there were still glaciers. So quickly are things moving. As governor, we took action to make a new policy. We decoupled the misaligned profit relationship between utility revenues and electricity consumption. We passed climate change legislation, setting goals, deadlines, and action plans for achieving a 25% greenhouse gas reduction by 2025. We took our renewable portfolio from a voluntary 7% to a mandatory 20% by 2022. We passed net metering and put incentives in place to reduce energy consumption by 15% by 2015. And along the way, we became one of the very first states to join REGI, the Regional Greenhouse Gas Initiative in Northeast states. We became one of the first states to adopt the International Green Building Code. And it took us 3 tries, but eventually we also passed a bill setting up a bidding process for Atlantic offshore wind, a state that was nowhere in terms of green job creation a few years before, achieved over the course of just 8, the fastest rate of green job creation of any state in the country. Now, none of that was easy, and all of it required persistence and persuasion and consensus and understanding and, yes, work and follow through. I was elected in 2006 and then reelected by twice the margin in 2010. And part of the reason, I believe, was the fact that so very little of this required a huge chunk out of people's energy bills. We used to have an image we would share at community meetings of the psychedelic dollar, and you could see out of any energy bill, just a small sliver was actually what it took for the renewables, for the energy, the peak reduction demand, and conservation efforts. Pennies, really. And oftentimes offset by the demand reduction efforts. The practical point of this trip through accomplishment lane is this. With the exception of the deconfliction and lease work for offshore wind, all of these actions in our state were accomplished without any help from anyone in the executive branch of our federal government or even our congressional delegation. And the state of Maryland was not alone in her leadership. Today, 23 states have now adopted decoupling policies. Today, 41 states have now adopted net metering. Today, 19 states have greenhouse gas emission targets. 26 states now have mandatory renewable energy portfolio standards. 22 states have now adopted energy efficiency standards and targets. Let me state it plainly. This is not a matter of hoping or wishing it. We need to act. And if federal efforts are sidelined for the next 4 years, then states like California, Maryland, and cities and others must lead just like we have for the last 8 years. This election means the loss for a time of American political leadership, but it does not mean the loss of leadership by Americans, by all of you. And this is why your work is so very important. Remember, the executive branch and Congress had nothing to do with the green building revolution in the past. So nothing has changed with this election, except the level of ignorance. You are transforming homes into technologies in which people dwell. And where it's headed is something quite remarkable. Throughout the United States of America, our buildings account for 39% of our carbon emissions. And the vast majority of our buildings are clustered in our cities and metropolitan areas, those places where mayors, regardless of party, are pushing the envelope of the possible. Living buildings, micro apartments, urban farming, building retrofitting, and it's all happening alongside of effective mayoral leadership. It's not enough that we cap new carbon emissions. We must draw down the poison that's already there. To do that, we must reimagine and redesign our way of living. And unless we act, unless we create a better story, unless we build metaphorically and literally a better, smarter home out of the surface of this planet, the science is going to catastrophize the future. And with some reason, the data support it. The problem is this, though. Catastrophizing the future, you know, connecting the dots and drawing straight line projections to hell makes deniers look optimistic and turns science into the problem. But you here understand an important truth. As our problems are man and woman made, so too are their solutions. And we need to work the problem, people. Recently, Green Builder Media and Shelter Dynamics built the Ark House, a home that brings together science and economy, a home that is smart, self-sufficient and compact, a new kind of home, a home that produces and gives to the grid more renewable energy than it consumes. Yours, then, really is the new story, the story of greater health, greater well-being, greater prosperity. And it is emerging from the dead wood of growth for the sake of growth, but it will not happen by itself. We need leaders, artists, you. We need you to write it. We need you to design it. And we need you to build it. The story of justice, balance, and regeneration emerging green for the sake of our children and grandchildren from the ashes of extraction and depletion. A true story. A story worthy of the love and the hearth of a great people. Conclusion. Fire. Imagination. The importance of place. The power of story. We human beings are problem-solving animals. There would be no freedom of the Exodus story without the slavery without Pharaoh's slavery. There would be no American Revolution without British oppression. There would be no penicillin without disease. And all transformation, all human progress requires first the letting go of something old, the tyranny of the way we've always done it, old stories that no longer serve. There is no independent salvation on this planet. And that is good news. So be not afraid and believe. We are Americans. We make our own destiny. Never doubt it. For as a great man once said, the day will come when after harnessing the ether, the winds, the tides, and gravity, we shall harness for God the energies of love. And on that day, for the second time in history, human beings will have discovered fire. Thanks very much.